They're going to introduce you to the role and function of the mounted brass, which applies for the Confederate cavalry as well. They're going to introduce you to the horse. They're going to introduce you to the man. They're going to introduce you to the equipment. They're going to introduce you to the weaponry and the tactics that the cavalry deployed in battle. Talk about the role and function of these horses. During the course of the program, they're also going to fire one weapon of the many that the cavalry did have, and that's the carbine. The fighters of this battle, like the people historically, each man will light fire about 60 to 70 grains of black powder. It's going to be a little loud. So when you go to fire, you have a hearing aid, turn it down. Also, you're going to protect your ears, get your cup covered, plug up your ears. That should be the trick. Finally, one more thing for your own safety. When you fire weapons, light fire weapons, along with a 1,000-pound animal, no matter how well they're trained, there's a safety issue there. Company A, 2nd U.S., is the best in the nation with their safety and their horses. But we want to protect you folks, and your safety is our paramount concern. So we will rapid test this. In case there's a problem with the horse, with the weapon, or the fuel, you know it's going to be safe and suffering from that problem. I was going to say, now you folks know where taxpayer money goes. So come on in, get nice and close. We encourage you to do so. Come nice and close up to the barricade.
He can only speak up so loud, guys.
Just inspect that barricade during the course of the battle. Horse's muzzle right up here next to you. Definitely ask you any questions you have at that time. So thank you so much for supporting our little district. Fine group. 87 Pennsylvania, Calvert Bell Fighting Drum over at the Pennsylvania Monument. And right out here at Pitzer Woods, one of the best cavalry groups in the nation. Company A, 2nd U.S. Every weekend in those years that I've spent with them, they've always made my stay with them very stress-free and very low-key. So to introduce you to the role and function of the mounted brass, I would like to introduce you to a gentleman who's been coming here for all those years with the 2nd U.S. Cavalry. Extremely knowledgeable about the mounted branch of service. Going to share some of that knowledge with you. Lieutenant Colonel United States Air Force retired, and my good friend, Mr. David Mize.
Ladies and gentlemen, thank you for joining us today in Pitzer's Wood on Gettysburg Battlefield. We're glad to be here. Tom says we give up our weekends. We consider it to be a privilege that we do so, and in memories of our ancestors. But you wouldn't be here, neither would we, if we didn't have this national park land to do it with. And the people that keep that pristine is the National Park Service, the men and women who are almost always unseen and certainly always unsung. Let's have a hand for them. This is my safety brief. Yes, I'm very experienced with black powder and horses, and if you see me start to run, please get out of my way. Also, you might want to try to keep up. We'll do our best. We haven't had any really serious stuff in a long time. But people do fall off horses or pulled off horses, guns will miss fire. That is not something you need to particularly worry about. That's just up to us. Let us talk a little bit about the cavalry and the role of the cavalry in the 1860s. American cavalry has always been what has been termed light dragoons. We've never had use for heavy cavalry. Think of the Queen's Guard with the breastplates, the helmets, and the high stiff boots on the huge horses with big tall men. We never kind of needed that because we never had an enemy to fight like that. the same time, light cavalry is pretty much what dragoons were during the Revolutionary War, and it was carried to a higher level in the next generation. So consider what you see out there as light cavalry, dragoons. And in fact, 2nd U.S. was the 2nd Dragoons until 2 weeks after 1st Manassas, when the federal government changed all of the mounted outfits to cavalry. Cavalry, of course, is indicated by that what they called the gaudy yellow. The dragoon would have worn orange striping on there. In fact, they were very proud of their history, been since 1836, and they were allowed to wear that uniform until it fell apart. By 1863, here at Gettysburg, there was very little yellow and orange left. That's called gaudy yellow. The primary roles of the cavalry, there are actually 11 listed in the manuals, but three of them pretty much sum it up. That's scouting, looking for the other guy's forces, screening, keeping the other guy's forces from looking at yours, and skirmishing, stopping them, pinning them in place. All of those are in use here at Gettysburg when Buford's boys skirmished the Confederates to halt down the road a little bit, scouted and found out where the Confederates were and that the fact they were concentrating here at Gettysburg, and screening, which did not work in Lee's case. His cavalry failed to let the Confederates find out, let the Federals know where his forces were at. So you had both failures and successes of the cavalry right here at Gettysburg to determine much of the battle. The first shot of that battle was fired by what had become, by that time, the primary weapon, carbine. It's an Italian name for short-barreled rifle. The federal mounted soldier, was the best armed soldier on the battlefield, and his technology showed it. Confederates were still carrying muzzle-loading rifles on their back. One shot, you're not going to reload on horseback. Federal forces had the advantage of having breech-loading carbines. The powder and shot mixed in one paper or linen cartridge, inserted through the rear, capped off and fired. Six aim shots a minute. Adrenaline pumping, you could do better than that. But what he was fighting with somebody doing this, 3 aim shots a minute, but they were good out to 450 to 300 yards or 350 yards. Whereas one of these, let's get out to 150. I fired them, they're accurate and deadly out to 150. Beyond that, it's anybody's word, yes. But the cavalry's role was not to sit off at a distance and bang away. Cavalry needed to demonstrate some personal. I am armed, you know. This is part of this, the close in and personal weapon, the revolver. Almost all federal troops were issued a revolver, not necessarily a Colt, which is what this is. Colt and Remington were pretty common. Colt was the most common until the Colt factory burned down in 1864. Besides, he was charging too much, the government's about to ding anyway. This is good for 6 shots. As fast as you can thumb back the hammer and pull the trigger. That's fine. That doesn't sound like much to us. They're used to 30-round magazines. But at that time, a generation before, was a single-shot pistol. So that 5 extra shots was a great deal of firepower. It was good after about 50 yards, once again. Having fired it live at 50 yards is deadly accurate. Beyond that, it's anybody's guess. But that's 50 yards on a bench, leaning against a tree, shooting downhill, no wind. But on the back of a horse, moving around, your sight picture is a little hard to capture on occasion. And in fact, one Confederate general said, quite succinctly, to be sure that you've hit your man on horseback with a pistol, you must press the muzzle against his breast and note the burning hole in his coat. The third weapon, you might think this is the last, it isn't. The third weapon in the arsenal is what's called the arme blanche by the French, in other words, the combat weapon. Characteristic of the cavalry. This is an 1840 wrist breaker saber. Here's my trick question. You don't answer it, she knows it. What defines this as a saber? Anybody?
A curve?
No, but that's what everybody thinks. The fact is, the British, the Prussians, and the French preferred straight sabers because they used the point more than we did. It is easier to train a cavalryman to use the edge to cut than it is to thrust, but a thrust is more deadly. And I'll explain that one in a little bit too. There is an advantage to the curve. A saber is a sword with a single sharpened edge. But what it does have in its advantage, if you can see that, is a very flat, very thick back edge. It's called a back sword. What that provides is a great wedge. Swung by a man with a lot of adrenaline going, that wedge with a sharpened edge is absolutely lethal. Mexican lancers found that out during the Mexican-American War when there's a line of them cleaved from crown to chin on the way to Mexico City. So it was not obsolete. It was not something to be unfeared. The Confederates went to great length to equip their troops with sabers, even though they didn't think much of them. In fact, less than 1% of the wounds certified during the war were created by swords and bayonets. It was just considered uncouth to cut or stab somebody. You know, you can blow them to bits with shrapnel, but yeah, uncouth to cut them. Last weapon for cavalrymen. Anybody got a clue?
The horse.
You are right. Look out there. What you're seeing is about 1,000 pounds of horse flesh and one horse. There's 14 horses out there. Try to imagine 100, which is about the size of a company. And that 100 in two ranks, so about 50 horses with the riders knee to knee, stirrup to stirrup, coming at you. All in blue. It looks like a wall. This wall that is glittering with steel. It's a psychological weapon. Usually people would break. That was what was used to make sure that you can run it. Because this charge is self-defeating. It starts off with a walk, goes into a trot, goes into a gallop in the last seconds before you hit, because it's easy to keep everybody together at enough speed. Once you go into gallop, it's not. Horses think of lions. As soon as they see you running, they go, it must be lions, and they're off to the races. But once they hit, everybody scatters and becomes an individual contest, and an individual horseman is losing part. So, signaling, please. Let's talk a second about signaling devices. During the Civil War, wireless was not in existence. Telegraph was the electronic communications at the time. While that was on the field, it was back at headquarters. When it came to the fight, you needed to give signals visually or orally, audio. Every branch had its own characteristic signaling device. The infantry was drums. They loved drums. They really loved drums. The problem with the drum is, what does it sound like? A gun going off. Well, you've got thousands of guns going off and somebody's beating a drum trying to tell you to go someplace. Good luck. You may not hear it. This doesn't sound like anything else on the battlefield. It's brassy, it's loud, it's obnoxious. By the end of the war, every branch was using the trumpet or the bugle to blow signals with. Unfortunately, they tended to not be sound the same, but they didn't mean the same things depending on the branch. By 1885, they were all changed and standardized. Now, an officer, I'm a lieutenant colonel of cavalry, indicated by the yellow strap, he had two buglers for his company, but they died fast because if you're a sharpshooter in the Confederates, you hear somebody use a signaling device. He's a legal, legitimate target. So the officer had to be able to blow the notes, and he carried a very small bugle to do that with. This is actually a troop-sized bugle. So here is the technique where you want to plug your ears, because I'm not a bugler, guys. What you would normally hear right now is a bugler with them sounding back a few notes, like da-da-da-da, which would be a preamble saying, I heard you, quit blowing that damn thing, we're coming. Troop is coming up in two ranks. Normally there would be
a wheel.
Forgive me for turning my back on you, but I have to see what they're doing. I can't get the horses to read the scripts. And you tend to want to eat them.
Oh! Sir, are you coming to court?
I'm your number two. Ladies and gentlemen, let me introduce you to 2nd United States Cavalry Company A, ably commanded by Captain Scott Womack. Assisted by Sergeant Barry Cruz.
Carvey!
Please note that the captain, who is a very wise and experienced officer, has turned the drill over to the sergeant.